The earth belongs to us. We belong to the earth. A gracious morning and a warm welcome to all of you to the second phase of webinar series, Wildlife and the Pandemic, the other side of the coin, organized by the Wildcos Club, PG and Research Department of Zoology and Wildlife Portal of India. I humbly request Ms. Kode Swaminathan, scuba diver and conservationist, to introduce the guest speaker of today's session.
He has volunteered in many places such as Blue Cross of India, Tamil Nadu Forest Department, Madras Crocodile Bank Trust, Wildlife Nature Conservation Trust, and has been a snake rescuer for average of 14,700 ethical rescues throughout India. He has also rescued other endangered species and has successfully transferred them to the wild. He is also involved in Gharial Conservation Alliance and also worked in marsh crocodiles in Methur. I call upon Mr. Nishant, the speaker.
So, good morning to everyone. And I'm Nishant, and I mean, basically from Chennai, but I'm currently working in Pune for one of the NGOs called Rescue Charitable Trust. So here I work as a wildlife head. So I am majorly taking part in wildlife rescues and rehabilitation of all mammals and reptiles. And today we are going to talk more about mammals and their problems faced by them in the city areas, as well as what all they are facing in the forest limits and how is it reacting on them during pandemic and normal times right now. So before I start, I would, I mean, I don't want to talk too much in depth about the mammal description and characterization, because you people are very much into zoology. So I don't want to talk in depth. I would like to share my experiences, and probably I would like to tell more about the current scenarios which are happening on the basis of mammals and the habitat restoration. So pandemic, as we all know, like, we have been going through a very bad phase the last 1.5 years or so, and it may continue for another year or so until things come under control. So how does this affect the entire mammal, not only mammal, all animal life, you know? I mean, I would like to give few examples. So yesterday, I don't know if the news is still out or not, there was a hyena, I mean, a striped hyena and tiger serious fight which happened in the middle of Mudumalai Road, you know, the connection in between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So on the highway, the fight happened. Generally, the forest is actually divided into public safari zone, core zone, and buffer zone. So all these, so South India major tiger reserves or any protected areas, you won't be allowed inside on the name of safari, like how it happens in other parts of the country. Like if you take Tadoba or if you take Kaziranga, you'll be taken directly into buffer zone on the name of safari. But states like Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra, Kerala have some restrictions in going inside, because we are way more concerned about the animals. So sighting an animal on a normal road in Mudumalai National Park is not that easy. You may come across elephants and deers, but not like animals like tigers and striped hyena. So since the lockdown has begun, the entire highway has been shut, and there's no access of public to get into the private, I mean, the safari zones also, and the people incoming, outgoing is also shut. So there was a intense fight yesterday. I mean, I got some videos also. I would like to share it late with you people. So a hyena and a tiger fight, which happened in the middle of the road, and finally the tiger won it. So it's actually some rare things are happening in the pandemic, because everything is shut. And if you take some tiger reserves like Tadoba and all, earlier, on a daily basis, there used to be like 300 to 400 safari vehicles going inside for almost 8 to 9 hours on a daily basis, morning and evening. So that used to put a lot of stress on the animals. They don't. So a mother with cubs can't wander freely inside the park, because everywhere safari people clicking pictures and everything is there. So in one month, small way, and there's another bad phase. So one good thing is like, the wildlife is getting their peaceful time, and there are things which are getting automatically restored in form of habitat. But on another phase, all the government officials are diverted, busy with the COVID scenario. And poaching situation is also getting worse. So right now under me, I've been working in Pune for last 2 years. So what has happened is lot of poaching activities have started. So for example, a few weeks back we rescued a leopard which was got caught in a foot trap. Unfortunately, the leopard also passed away. So the plan was to catch a leopard or a jackal on the foot trap and use the skin and all other thing for export purposes. And not only this, rhino cases in Kaziranga, there have been like 6 to 7 rhino poaching, horn poaching happened in last few months. That is again a massive number, 6 to 7. And there have been elephant attack, I mean elephants being killed for the ivory also, which hasn't still come out as a report, but it has happened in last few months. So poaching activity has also become a very it has become and very importantly I want to say is like the wildlife trafficking has become worse in this condition. So what is happening with wildlife trafficking is we have been getting a lot of animals from Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia on the name of exotic pets, and all are being massively spread across the country. So you won't believe me, I have some stats and I have some numbers with me. In last 2 months, from a consignment from Bangkok, we have received close to 1,800 iguanas, and we have got the critically endangered sulcata tortoise from Africa. We have got 400 to 500 poisonous dart frogs, and we have got some king cobras, Thailand king cobras. We have got, if I'm not wrong, we have got ball pythons in huge numbers. Like I'm talking about like massive numbers, like 5,000 to 6,000 numbers, which is just of hatchling size. Why I'm telling all these things is because exotic is again like, as a zoology student, as you are well aware of these things, people, I mean, you can't release them back in the wild. And once they start growing with you as a pet, they start showing their aggression. That is when you feel like either you want to give it to the people who have zoo, or you want to give it to the government, or for sure they will also reject, because already countries like us, I mean, our wildlife situation, we have a lot of cases inload with us only. We can't care for other exotic animals. So government or any other zoo is going to definitely tell no to it, and you'll be in a situation where people are gonna, I mean, you'll be in a situation either to leave the animal in the wild, which can't be done because it's going to spoil our living, I mean our Indian species also. So exotic is going massive, our poaching is going massive, but few places there are good things always happening. And even if you take marine, I guess Kode would have spoken, I mean spoken a lot about the last session, but still marine, how it is affecting. You have a lot of garbage, like especially gloves, masks, PPE suits, all ending up in the sea, all being washed up on the beaches. All life cycle is being hit in that way. After this pandemic is over, I guess every person in the country globally should work on the garbage management, because the usage of everything is getting more, like mask to gloves. Every day, on an average, a person is using 2 to 3 masks. And if you're into medical field, you're using a lot of PPEs. And if you're getting affected because of COVID, again, you're using PPE suit. And all these are not disposed properly. So once the disposal is wrong, it ends up into the wild, either in form of forest or in marine life. So there is a massive impact through garbage on the wildlife, you know. So I guess Pranita will be talking more about that in the upcoming session. So let us get into mammals, and as I speak, I'll share my experiences and whatever is happening currently. I would like to thank the Lady Doc management and WPI for giving me this opportunity. And generally, I generally like prefer talking more about reptiles because I'm mostly into reptiles. But again, I worked with mammals too, so I mean, this is one of the sessions where I'm talking something different and feeling very good to interact with people. So I'm pretty excited to have an interaction with you people. So this is again like a very common thing which I don't want to tell in that. I mean, presence of memory, I mean, memory glands, warm-blooded, give birth to live ones, four-chambered heart, presence of diaphragm, one tooth replacement. Like all these things are like very much familiar for you people when it comes to mammals. So I just don't want to talk more about it. Can you just go with the next slide? Yeah. Human beings, the most invasive mammal, most invasive primate to be precise. So I would tell that human beings are the worst mammals, I would say. Like, I mean, in fact, we are the worst. I mean, we are doing the most destruction to all part of the life, you know, like let it come to us, or let it be the animals, or let it be the environment. We have been ruining it, and it is the right time where we start doing something good to them so that we'll get something good out of it. Because nature and environment is such a way that when we do something good to them, definitely in return it will give much more stronger than what we think. You know, they do something more powerful. You can see the wonders when you do something very small. So say, for example, if you ask a child to plant a tree at a house level, let us pour water and take care of the plant for a 15-year period. I mean, that itself is a very big skill. It's actually taking care of a kid from childhood to adulthood, you know, like how they work. So that plant will become a tree, and that will attract a bird. That bird will do the germination stuff, and it goes and drops the seed somewhere, and again that plant grows over there. It's again like one good thing you've done, you know. So every human, I mean, it's not a responsibility of every environmentalist or conservationist just to protect nature. It's everybody's role to play. So next slide, please. So again, yeah, in this session we are going to talk about the habitat wise. So we will be talking animals habitat wise. So we'll be covering upon the Himalayan animal, we'll be covering about the grasslands, we'll be covering the jungle animals, we'll be talking about the urban wildlife, what are the issues they are facing. So the next slide. So urban mammals. So I again, like you people, this college is from Madurai, and I'm very much aware about the problems faced by Madurai people when it comes to animals. So I've been working there with few people in and around that area. So it's again majorly monkeys and spotted deers in few places. Monkeys are the major problems caused in across India. I mean, not across India, across the globe. So deer. So I'll start with deers. Deer, again, we very commonly found deers are like spotted deer, barking deer. There are more common deers like blackbuck and chinkaras and four-horned antelopes. All these animals are found in different parts of city. When it comes to Chennai as an example, we have a lot of blackbucks and spotted deers. So what are these animals facing as a problem? So I would like to give an example of IIT Madras. So IIT Madras is a college which is surrounded by Guindy National Park, and the college itself is inside a forest. So earlier, it used to be a very dense forest where the animals had a lot of space to roam around. But now what has happened is a lot of construction because of the college, and they have been destroying the forest in a massive way, which is, again, I won't tell it's a mistake by the college officials, because they have to expand it because the college has a lot of other expansion programs, like a lot of students coming in, a lot of departments and everything. But again, the animals which are living there, they are forced to move outside. So what is happening? They have started coming out of the compounds, and they started feeding on the garbages outside. So people who are from Chennai are very well aware about it, like areas like Velachery, Guindy, and Taramani. What happens is they come during the early morning of 4 o'clock, and they start feeding the garbages in the residential area. And again, by early like 10-ish, they get back into the college compound. So what is happening to them is they are feeding on all type of garbages, like medical waste, the garbage which is thrown by us. So they, if you do a postmortem of one deer, for sure you'll find minimum to 15 to 16 kgs of plastics in it. And we have been getting news now that most of the deers inside IIT and in and around IIT having bloated stomach. Bloated stomach means there is a lot of plastics inside, and this may affect them anytime in coming days. And next one is black buck. I just spoke monkey. So everybody generally tells that there is always a problem with monkey when it comes into your residential area. So the reason why monkeys are coming is again the habitat restoration. So, and one other thing is our garbage management. So if you being in a society, if you are very responsible, then you have to throw your garbages properly. And when you see a lot of wildlife around you, you have to be more careful. So I live in a city like Pune. Pune has a lot of wildlife in city. So it's surrounded by mountains. The weather is apt for the wildlife. So from my house, like 5-6 kilometers from my house, we sight a leopard on daily basis. We see a lot of deers around my houses. So our society in particular, we make sure the garbage is disposed properly so that the monkeys or any animal doesn't need to eat that food. So if a monkey is in your area, and if your garbage management is bad, what happens? A monkey will come and eat that. And it's easy for an animal to get a food. When they get food, they just stay back. They don't need to hunt. They don't need to do anything. So in that way, they settle there only and they start losing their instinct of hunting. So, and say, for example, all of a sudden you change the garbage management. You are doing good. After a monkey settled with your food and you suddenly change your garbage management way, the monkey will start going aggressive in search of food. So what will happen when a kid is eating something on the road, or when a school kid is returning with snack eating on the road, the monkey will start snatching the food. In that way, people will start complaining that the monkey is becoming aggressive, it's biting everyone. So the first and fourth mistake is like we feeding a wild animal. So feeding can be directly fed or it can be indirect. Indirect is the garbage management, which I was talking about. Directly is few people feel like monkeys are just like pets, so you would like to feed the animal. That is extremely wrong. Any wild animal which you see across your urban limits can't be fed. Wild animals need to be wild, and there is always a balance. If there is a imbalance happening in the chain, then there's going to be a massive problem. So make sure that you don't feed wild animals. And if you see someone feeding wild animals, please do tell them. Yes. So I would like to give another example. A couple of days back in Mumbai, there's an organization called RAW. So they rescued a bonnet macaque, which was 15 kg in weight. 15 kg in weight, full of obesity, cholesterol, and all other fatty body of the monkey. So why is it? Because that monkey stayed in Mumbai and it was being fed by people massively. In a society, every house in the society used to feed the monkey. And monkey are basically, when they get food, they make sure they eat everything and they store something in their mouth. So this animal has been going through intense food in the last 3-4 months. And now the animal has become into an abnormal shape where it's not able to move. And it was feeling sick and it was found in the apartment lying on the ground. So the officials have rescued the monkey now. They are treating the animal, but it's going to be a very, very long treatment process. So who are we supposed to blame in this? We can't blame the monkey. We can't blame the animal at all. So we have to blame ourselves. And the rehabilitation is going to take so long to get the monkey to normal that he is going to lose his instincts once he gets back into the wild. So this is another example. Mongoose. So there is again a myth in our country where people think is like when there is a lot of snakes around, then mongoose is around. It's not true. All animals are around you. It's just because the food chain. So it doesn't mean like there is a lot of snakes, then it's mongoose is there. It doesn't mean like there are mongoose, then a lot of snakes are there. It's all like myth, you know. Yeah, I agree that snakes and mongoose fight and mongoose feed on snakes and everything happens. But again, it's a chain. So people in living like Chennai, urban city, like Madurai cities, urban, where it's all full of cement jungle, you can understand that I have rescued a rat snake from 14th floor of LIC. You know, LIC building is the tallest building in Chennai, but I've rescued a snake from that 14th floor. You can imagine where all the snakes are living. So we are supposed to, I mean, every animal has a right. So we have used their land, we are used their water, we are staying in their place, then they also have a minimal right to stay. Only when an animal enters your house or only when an animal is showing its threat to you, that is when you have to call a rescuer or a forest department to rescue an animal. Otherwise, that animal also has a right to live in your place. Next one is civet cat. Civet cat in cities like Tamil Nadu and in states like Tamil Nadu, it's very rare to see around the city area. But where I'm living right now, there's a lot of civet cats. On a daily basis, we rescue 3-4 civet cats, which are being hit by vehicles, which are being stuck inside a forest, company compounds, company rooms and everything. They are again like typically like mongoose or monkey. Whenever they get food, they stay back. Otherwise, they keep moving on. And palm squirrel. Palm squirrel is a very common animal which you find across. I don't want to talk more about it. Indian boar. So Indian boar is also people. So Indian boar, generally it's a wild pig. So wild pig, people may think it's just a pig, but again, it's one of the most aggressive animals I've come across in the wild. And you have to be very, very much aware. I mean, if there's an animal around you, if a wild boar is around you have to be very careful because they charge at you very badly and they can give a nasty bite. And people think it's just a pig, so nothing will happen. But you have to make sure that you're very safe. And few cities like Chennai and Bangalore has some population of wild boars in the city. But again, I don't think that's a big threat or causing any issues. So let's go with the next slide. Yeah, I mean, it's again pictures for you. The top corner is civet cat, then monkey, then black buck, mongoose, again langur, spotted deer. So next slide. So grassland mammals. So these are one of my favorite subject, grassland. So because in and around Pune, it's mostly grasslands, and I have seen my favorite animals, which we have listed in that. It's Indian grey wolf, striped hyena, fox, Indian jackal, and Asian wild dog, which is also called as dhole. So can you just go to the next slide? I'll show the pictures. Yeah. So hyena. I mean, I would the only animal which is more smart and intelligent, but people hate it while seeing it. You know, they look really ugly, they smell very bad, but one of the most intelligent animal, I would say. I mean, right now we have couple of hyenas under rehabilitations also in Pune. One is a orphan and another one is an adult, which got again trapped by foot trap, you know. So hyena, I mean, they are typically scavengers, you know. They how vultures are like very important in eating the final bits of a carcasses. Hyena plays that important role. So say for example, if a leopard has eaten a dog or a buffalo or a cow, the entire meat part and fleshy part is eaten by the leopard. Then comes the jackal, which eats again the fleshy part. Then comes the dhole, fox, they'll also eat the fleshy part. And the bony part and the final part is eaten by vulture and hyena. Hyena plays a very important role in finishing the carcasses. They eat anything and they can crush the bones very easily, like how we eat other things, you know. I mean, their jaw power is so, I mean, the power you can't imagine. The jaw power, the bite power is equal to a crocodile bite. So it's one of the most strongest animal which I've seen when it comes to lifting the carcasses or anything. So hyena is there, and again, dholes. Dhole population in South India is very much high. I mean, we can see it everywhere, almost protected areas, and it's again one of the most intelligent animals. They hunt in packs. They go around in packs and they kill. They don't kill an animal. They catch an animal and they eat the animal life. So that is one of their habits, you know. They go as a big pack. So generally, an alpha leads the pack, and they surround a particular animal. They choose that animal and they make sure they catch that animal. And once they catch the animal, they don't kill the animal. They directly eat it live. So a pack is minimum about 15 to 20 individuals, and they can finish an animal within like 2 3 minutes because they eat only when they are hungry. Otherwise, they just stay and stay back and do the basking part. Again, gray wolf. Gray wolf is again a very important animal to our. I mean, it also plays something like hyena. And now, recent study tells that a lot of wolves. We have been losing a lot of wolves because of CD, canine distemper. And why is it? Because there is again a lot of dog population inside the grassland area. And basically, grassland is again used by a lot of public in form of grazing and sheltering wise. If you see shepherds, they go with goats, cows, bulls, everything for grazing. So once the grazing is done, for sure they take their dogs with them. And these dogs, they stay back there, they turn into packs and they start attacking all these animals. There are recent cases where a pack of normal stray dogs have attacked animals like hyena, wolf, leopards everywhere in Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh. That's becoming more common because the stray population has become more in the grassland and forest area. So the next one is jackal and fox. So jackal is again very commonly found everywhere. Everywhere. I mean, their population is too good as of now. There's no. Again, the only issue with them when it comes to like urban wildlife people, I mean urban cities, what the problem they face is when they come into the outskirts of the forest area, they start eating again our garbage and meat waste and everything which is thrown by the slaughterhouses and which is owned by us, you know, they come very close to people, but again they don't attack really. They just have their food and they are more scared than what we are, so they just run back. And again, fox as usual. All these animals come into one same family, but again everybody has a different role to play. And grasslands, so what are the problems faced by the grassland ecosystem now? So so when grasslands are very much very, I mean I would say like central states and western states in the country have a very good habitat, I mean huge habitat for huge habitat grassland they have. What happens is a lot of grazing happens and the animals stay there, the shepherd also stay there, and the animals keep eating it. So grasslands is again used by us only. I mean it should be equally distributed. Say if your pack of animals are grazing on that, then they have to leave that area so that these animals can play an important role on it. So it's again a food chain, you know, that food chain is getting spoiled there. So restoration is happening in a very big pace. I would like to give a chain example. So an animal grazing, a cow is grazing on the grassland area, so it'll eat the grass, it'll uproot all the roots and go. So that uproot roots can be eaten up by the hares, wild hare. And again, that wild hare is eaten by these animals like jackals, fox, and everything. Again, these foxes and jackals are eaten by animals like gray wolf, hyena, leopard. Again, they have another larger predator in form of birds when they die. So it's a chain. So this entire chain is getting spoiled because there is no grassland only. So everything is used by public. I mean, everything is used by common people in form of grazing. So in that way, all these animals are forced to enter into human settlement in search of food, in search of water, because there's nothing left in their places. So when they enter inside, people think it's a threat and they make sure they kill the animal, you know. So that is happening. Next slide, please. Jungle mammals. So again, can you just go back? I'll just read out one name. So bison and gar. So this is again one of the huge, I mean one of the huge mammal we find in our country, which I mean everybody would have seen. And there is, I mean Madurai people, you must be aware of the conflict which is happening in Kodaikanal when it comes to gar. There's a lot of gar population in the city which roams like cows and bulls, you know, and I guess you people are very aware about it. What problems these animals face? So commonly if you see the animals like bison, sambar, barking deer, four-eyed antelope, black buck, rhesus macaque, langur, and elephant, porcupine. These are one category of animals. They generally feed on grass, so grass and forest animals. So what are the problems faced by them in the forest area? So the first and foremost is habitat restoration. You destruct the entire habitat of them, and they come into your area for food and they come into your area for water. So that is the first and foremost. Second thing is on the name of tourism. So tourism should happen. Basically, if you take a point of view from my point of view as a conservationist, as a rehabilitator, for a common public to know something about an animal or to know something about a particular species, you have to go and see them in person and then learn how things are. So if I would like to learn about some snake, I make sure I go to that place, I see the snake in person, but I stay away from a far distance. I see how it happens, how the snake behavior is, what it happens, and then I come back. So that learning thing has to happen for everyone, you know. Everyone can learn things only when they see it. So in that way, it should happen. I mean, tourism should be there, but it should be in a restricted way. There should be some norms like you shouldn't reach this animal this close, you shouldn't do these things. So there should be some norms. So that norms has to be regulated. Otherwise, tourism is going to be a very big issue for the animals. And I would like to give an example. So again, climatic weather changes, how climate affects. So if you take hill stations like Kodaikanal, Ooty, the temperature earlier used to be very, the winters used to be really cold, but now the winters are not that cold. Why? Because again, the climatic condition, lot of pollution, lot of tourism. Again, the tourism is not only in common areas, the tourism is across the forest areas and inside the jungles. So that has to stop. When you stop that only, the animals are in peace, and that is when the entire area will get a time to restore themselves, you know. So I would like to give an example of Kaziranga here. Kaziranga is a huge national park which supports animals like elephants, rhinos, wild buffaloes, water buffaloes, swamp deer, spotted deer, black bucks. Every herbivore and omnivore, all big cats are there in that Kaziranga. But that Kaziranga requires floods every year. If Kaziranga doesn't flood one year, then the entire habitat is gone. Why is it? Because there is a population of the entire Kaziranga population, 90% of Kaziranga population depends on grass. If the grass has to grow the entire year, then the flood should happen because the water will equally get distributed across the park and the grass will keep growing in and these animals can graze. If one year the floods doesn't happen, then there is no chance of these grass to grow. So Kaziranga National Park, the grass height is like minimum 6 to 10 feet. They grow massive. That's where elephants, rhinos can eat peacefully. And when you consider big animals like rhinos and elephants, they need a minimum of 20 to 30 kilo of grass every day. So the entire park should sustain this much food for these many animals for the round year. So which means so much of flooding should happen every year. That is why every year there is a flooding happening in Assam. Why? Because Kaziranga needs it. Brahmaputra, that's how the nature is made. Brahmaputra is a huge river which gets flooded from Guwahati and it enters into Kaziranga and it goes out in another way. In on the way, it floods the entire Kaziranga plain and it goes back. So this flooding will make an increase in the grass in future. Like as in after the post-flooding, it's actually good for the grass to grow where the animals sustain on it. This cycle is a automatic cycle, I mean, which is made by nature. So if the flooding doesn't happen, it's done. Kaziranga is no more and no animals can sustain. So they'll start moving out. Once they start moving out in search of food, they get attacked by people or they don't get food and they starve to death. So every jungle has a role to play. So Kaziranga's terrain is like that. Grassland terrain is another way. Jungle mammal terrain is also another way. And there is a huge migrations happening in form of elephants. So if there is elephant population in Western Ghats, in summer time there is no water in Tamil Nadu. So what happens is they directly enter into water bodies areas like Kerala and Karnataka. There you have enough water, but again the population of that states will get affected because our animals are going there. And post monsoon in Kerala there is good water, but by the end of winter, what happens? The animals in Kerala doesn't have food and water because of the habitat loss, so they enter into Tamil Nadu to eat food. So everywhere these animals are migrating in search of food, which they earlier used to do it. That is their migration pattern, and elephant corridors are there. But now lack of food, they're going here and there, and which is causing a lot of problem. And recently, you would have read an article, and you would have seen the viral video where these Chinese elephants walk close to 500 kilometers from a national park to another national park in China. If I'm not wrong, people would have read it for sure. So these are the places where these elephants used to migrate, and we have used their parts of migration and everything. And Mudumalai, if you take Mudumalai National Park, recently shut close to 300 resorts inside the park. Why? Because all these 300 parks come under elephant corridor, and it was a really good decision made by the Supreme Court and the state court, and they made sure all the resorts are closed. Now the elephants are wandering happily in that area because it's their area, and we have occupied it on the name of our fun resort and tourism. So these are the few issues which are faced by jungle mammals. And when I talk about Indian leopard, Bengal tiger, pangolin, so these are the most trafficked. Pangolin is one of the most trafficked animal across the globe. And again, the trafficking is so huge that the population is going drastically down and a lot of conservation efforts are happening on pangolins. And tigers and leopard population is slightly under control as of now. But the thing is, people are very happy, excited about the tiger population going very high from 2009 to 2021. The population has grown like almost 100% more than what we have. But the problem is, say for example, if there were 50 tigers in 2009 and now we have 100 tigers, and for the 50 tigers we had 5% of land in 2009, now we have 4% of land for 100 tigers. So this calculation is totally wrong. What happens is, when you are concentrating on the conservation aspect of an animal, then you have to concentrate on the restoration of the habitat. If you make more jungle, then the tiger is basically a territorial animal. So you need to give them the territory. That is when they can go around and they can mark their territory. When there is no jungle, they end up in village area, which will again lead to man-animal conflict. So where the tiger is either named a man-eater or where the tiger is being put down. So these are the only things, or they'll be caught and they'll be kept in the zoo for public display. So I'm one person who's not really happy with the tiger number increasing, unless you do a very good number of increase in the forest land. If you don't do the increase in forest land, then there's no point in conserving any animal. So habitat is a very important thing, which we have to consider in from today we have to start considering about the habitat restoration part. Next slide, please. Yeah, again, I mean, whatever I said, these are the pictures, and mostly you would have seen all these vital pictures going here and there. Next slide. So again, this is again a very interesting sector. So smooth-coated otter, fishing cat, rusty spotted cat, spot-clowned otter, Eurasian otter. So I know, I mean, otters are generally animals which stay nearby the river banks and lakes and everything. They feed on all these fishes. Again, these guys are one of the fastest moving animal in the water, and again, smartest also in the water. They are very good hunters. They go again in packs to hunt. A pack can be anywhere in between 3 to 5 people. And otters are pretty rare to be seen because most of us are always busy with targeted and highlighted animal like tiger, lion, leopard, elephant. You go in search of them, but you don't go in search of all these small animals. So otters are, I basically don't like going in search of big animals like elephant, leopard, tiger, because it's very commonly found. And if you want to see a tiger, you can just visit one of the Central India National Parks, or if you want to see an elephant, you can go anywhere. But to see some small animals like rusty spotted cat, fishing cat, otter, it's going to be really rare because their population are declining like anything. Why? Again, because they depend on particular things. So if you take the fishing cat, that fishing cats need particular kind of a habitat, which is only found in and around West Bengal. So Sundarbans area terrain, all these terrain are habitat for them. And they have a very minimal diet. And if that food is available only, they eat it. Otherwise, they can't survive along. So that's the reason this fishing cat population is going really down. And if you take rusty spotted cat is the world's smallest cat. World's smallest wild cat, I would say. Pretty much intelligent. They are very good climbers of tree. They're very good in adapting everything. They are very commonly found everywhere. But again, the population is getting reduced because of farming. And we are farming, we are doing. And what is happening, farmers generally, to catch the rats and everything, they do all the poisoning thing, urea thing and everything. So rats will also eat them. Once the rats eat them, these rusty catch them, so the rusty will die. So it's again, the chain is getting affected. So all these animals are very small. People don't concentrate on them, but we are doing a direct impact on them by killing their habitat, which indirectly is going to kill them. So these animals, as a group of zoology students, I would prefer, like, I would like all you people to just concentrate on smaller animals rather than targeting the bigger animals in case if you're planning to pursue in the research field of wildlife, you know. Next slide. The aerial mammal. So this is again one of my favorite animals. So I'm talking about the bat species. So which is again a fruit bat or a fox bat, flying fox bat. Next slide, picture please. So a lot of rumors going around COVID source from bat and from China, this, that. And again, we had this viral infection from Kerala also suggesting that these bats have caused it and everything. But again, bats are one of the most smartest and intelligent animal. They have a different way of living compared to other mammals. And these animals do carry rabies. These are rabies affected because their way of living, their way of eating things, they do carry rabies. But again, not all animals carry rabies. Not all individuals, I would say. So I handle them daily. We have so many bats under my rehabilitation. So these guys, we handle them. They generally, like how we take care of other animals, you know, they are so friendly that they climb on your hands, they lick your, they sense your fingers. Wow, I would say one of the most innocent animal which being killed just because some rumors are going here and there. I've seen in cities like Chennai, once the virus came, all people in IIT and Guindy National Park and all these governors building, people started killing these bats very ruthlessly because they were scared that these animals are spreading virus. But in fact, there is no proven fact still that these animals are spreading. And even if these animals are spreading, there are other solutions, but there's nothing like you have to kill it, you know, and that solution is like you have to take care of them. A lot of bat experts are suggesting that because of these rumors, the population of bats have totally come down across the globe, especially after this pandemic series. These are the one of the most affected species, I would say. This will be on my top three list, you know, which is being affected because of the pandemic, just because their name is used in the virus, you know. Otherwise, though, there's nothing like proven right now when it comes to bat. Next slide, please. So this is again, like, again, a very favorite part. So there's another entire habitat where we are going to talk about the Himalayan and snowy regions. So snow leopards are one of the most, I would say, like, innocent leopards I've seen in my life. I was lucky to rescue a few of them also in Ladakh when I was working on one of the projects over there. And these animals are not facing the habitat restoration problem, but these animals are facing climatic changes. These climatic changes are again because of our tourism factor and lot of resorts and lot of hotels in and around their habitat, which is leading to noise pollution, normal climatic conditions because of our smoke and everything. So all these tourism right now, wherever you see in Himalayas, like take example of Himachal Pradesh, Kashmir, Sikkim, Arunachal, where these snow leopard populations are, they generally live in a higher peaks. So they prefer staying somewhere more than 15,000 feet on a snowy peak. So people now have a craze of going to all these peaks by their cars and two wheelers just to take a picture from the peak, like how trekkers do, no? Trekking is a different subject, but when it comes to going by road, you know, so you lay a road and that road will again take a lot of tourists in. Once tourists go to that particular point on the peak, then they feel like eating something. That is when the restaurant comes up. When the restaurant comes up, again, the garbage. So once the garbage is there, again, the wildlife around that area, like deers. And so you can see the other animals which have included is Himalayan deer, Himalayan musk deer. So these animals will come in search of that food. They eat the plastic. They go to the forest back. And again, snow leopard kills that animal. Then they also eat the plastic and the deer. So it's an entire chain which is being again affected on the name of tourism and us. And climatic condition is the worst. So a lot of glaciers and a lot of snow-filled mountains are getting totally dry because these animals generally prefer staying on the snow. With that temperature only they can live, otherwise they can't take that heat, you know. So now what is happening? So all these deer, say for example this Himalayan thar or blue sheep, they need grass to eat. So these animals, when they need grass, they come to the base of the hill. So which is mean they come around 8,000 to 10,000 feet altitude. So when these animals come to eat there, these snow leopards are also forced to come all the way down to catch them because that is their only source of food. So which means the animal from 16,000 feet is reaching to the 10,000 feet where he is getting a huge temperature difference and the climate is also really harsh. And to catch the animal is not very easy because the blue sheep are really fast climbers, jumpers. They run like anything. You would have seen a lot of crazy videos of snow leopard hunting deers, you know. So again, the cycle, as I say, so there is no grass on the top hill. So that's the reason they are forced to come down, because people started using those grass in those areas just to use it for the food, all these wood, firewoods and everything. So all these small things have been removed by us on the name of homestays and tourism. They get back all these woods to home. So there is no availability in and around the forest area. So they come down automatically wherever the grass is. And the only grass is where people do farming or people in and around their houses have it. And which means the snow leopards also come there to catch these guys. So either the snow leopard get attacked by them or the snow leopard gets a chance to eat the animal, but again, they get injured. Injured as in it can be in. So most of these animals, snow leopards, comes into areas where the shepherds are to catch the sheep or to catch a goat or to catch a cow. So that is when they get attacked by the other animals. Like, I rescued two snow leopards basically where they were attacked by cows. So they're very sensitive. So the cow horn has gone through and through of the body of snow leopard and they got injured very badly. So these are the other threats to them. They generally a fluffy big cat which has a very cute long tail, but otherwise aggression level, they are pretty much very innocent. They are not that aggressive when compared to other leopard cat, other big cats, you know. They are one of the most innocent cats I've seen in my life. And brown bear. Brown bear is again facing the same issues. Brown bear has another different issues, like their claws and their paws have been exported to China, basically because they use it for medicinal purpose and the claws have been used for chain dollars and everything. So the population in the country is very much declining right now because of all these things. And every bear has a hibernation period when it comes to Himalayan region. So a bear is generally active in between the month of April till November. That is when the summer, monsoon and autumn, spring, I would say, all these seasons are there. That is when they eat a lot. And once the spring season is over, the winter starts. So during the winter season, they go into hibernation. That hibernation part, they don't come for 4 to 5 months outside. So that is when they give birth to babies also. So because of this climatic condition, because there's the high increase in temperature, there is nothing called a hibernation period right now. In fact, in few places in Himachal, the bears have stopped going for hibernation because the climate is constant throughout summer, spring, winter, which is a really bad sign, because an animal like bear has to go into hibernation. That is when they give birth to an animal. So giving birth is what they do in the hibernation. So when we cancel that entire hibernation period, then there is no increase in the population. So which means again, the climatic condition is drastically changing. So in order to control things of this terrain, you know, what we have to do is we have to plant more trees over there, remove tourism drastically. We should stop the entire tourism activity and give the space for the nature to restore by itself, you know. So that process is happening in few places already, places like Kashmir and Ladakh, you know. Many places where the bears are found, they've started doing it. I make sure that something good happens in that area in form of water, something good happens in that area in form of plantation of trees or something, so that we give some space for the animal. Otherwise, after doing so much of effort rehabilitating a orphan hyena pup, say for example, right now I've got a hyena pup which is like 90 days old. He's going to be with us for next 6 months. I'm trying to rewild them. So once I rewild it, I release back into the wild. But already the animal which is there in the wild is 1,000 times aggressive and more wild than what I've done in my center, you know. So when they go there, they need to sustain at least for a few days to know how the wild works. So I make sure that all these restoration happens before I go there. So in form of water, I release, I make a soft release kind of thing where I fence that area with some animals in that, live animals like some wild hare and deers, injured deer, we make sure we put it there. So these animal has a chance to eat that animal. So they'll get the wild instinct. So all these things should happen when you release an animal or when you're thinking about a conservation point of view. Everything should be sorted before doing anything. So it's a chain again. So not to, if I'm rescuing an animal and releasing, it doesn't mean my role is done. But there should be forest. So people have to do something for the forest. People have to do something related to tourism. People have to work on the research part, how these animals are getting affected. So every cycle is important when it comes to conservation. It's not like a one-man job or one profession just working over there. Next. Yeah, I mean, whatever I told right now is what is there. Next slide, please. So conservation measures. So I've just taken a few examples of this. So there are a lot of conservation activities happening across the country as well as the globe. When it comes to our country, the first and foremost, the Forest Department, with our forest manpower and with our massive habitat and massive animal diversity, I would say our Forest Department is doing a wonderful job. And earlier it used to be all under some private NGOs and private groups where they were helping the Forest Department with conservation. But right now, Forest Department is well educated and well aware about few projects. So if you take places like Kaziranga, the entire rescue operation to forest fire to protection of animals is done by Forest Department only. Only once the animal is rescued, then there's another NGO called W2A who takes care of the animal. But from the start till almost rescue situation, the department takes care of it because they are now trained in such a way that they can tackle any situation. So, I mean, Forest Department is also very good in, so every beat has a single guard who protects that area, animals. So they have a very important role to play. And people generally think that Forest Department is like another government job where they don't do anything. Yeah, I do accept there are few officials in and around the city limits who work like that. But in the national parks and in the protected areas, the Forest Department are really working hard to protect the habitat as well as to protect the animals. But again, there are a few instances where the government takes some harsh decision in name of mining and in the term of tourism, building huge buildings in the buffer zones and all these stuff. So that government decisions are affecting our habitat, but the department is doing their best role to save them. And there are other organizations everybody must be aware of: Wildlife SOS, WWF India, and you have this WTI, CWRC, all these big NGOs playing different part of projects. So if you take Madras Crocodile Bank, I was a part of that crocodile bank. So I worked for them with them for a few years on projects like gharials and muggers and freshwater turtle and Chambal, Sundarbans and all. And they also started this project called Student Sea Turtle Conservation Network in Chennai, which again works on Olive Ridley Sea Turtle. And they also have another NGO called Dakshin Foundation that is also again started by one of the branchy who worked from Crocodile Bank. And they have another project in Andamans going like in it. So they also work on local habitat restoration in Andaman. So every NGO has, I mean, basically in India, there are only like 10 to 15 NGOs who work on conservation, and all these NGOs works on all these animals, you know, just not only one particular terrain. So Crocodile Bank has played a very important role when it comes to reptiles. So they worked on crocodiles, they worked on gharials, they worked on freshwater turtle, they worked on snakes, they worked on habitat restoration. They are doing a lot of studies on when it comes to king cobras and Brussels vipers and everything. All these studies are happening. So again, WPI, I would like to take my rescue organization in Pune right now. We have been working massively when it comes to like leopards and all these big cats and crocodiles, which are again coming into city limits, which are causing problem for people. I mean, smaller organizations are also doing a very big impact. So when we take about the organization like Rescue where I'm working right now, it's a very small organization when compared to SOS and everything. But the work we do is like, we make sure that everything is in the balance. So we get an animal, injured animal, we treat it, we release it back. It's not only that, we make sure that the awareness is going there properly. And there are a few examples right now. I'm telling you, I just told that, as I told in the start, so we have a leopard conflict in the city, like Mumbai and Pune. We have leopards coming into big IT areas, parking. They come for search of dogs and everything. Huge population of leopards are there, but people are right now ready to stay along with the leopard because at the end of the day, they are not attacking any person. Once if an attack happens, that is when as a rescuer, we are forced to remove an animal from there and we have to release it in the wild back. But otherwise, right now, everything is under control when it comes to conflict situations. And next slide, please. I guess we are almost done with the thing. So this is my last slide. The word independent is a lie. We keep relying on the number of biotic and abiotic resources to live our lives of peace. Even the green plants that are known to be the most independent forms depend on sunlight and carbon dioxide. So this is again a very common thing. To keep it all right, there is a fine balance attached to the complex cycles and process the exit in the nature. If only all of us are oriented towards reaching the balance that was existing in our planet, it may work. Let's ensure the safety and well-being of what's around us, and we may get the chance to survive what's coming in the near future. So I would like to thank the management, and I would like to thank the WPI team for making this wonderful PPT. And I hope I get more questions from you people, so we'll have some interaction. And yes.
Thank you, sir, for your enlightening speech. You enhance with your knowledge about terrestrial mammals. Thank you, sir.